Hello and welcome to Waltrip Unfiltered. We've got another great episode today for you to listen to. Listen to me real quickly. Please tell your friends to go to their favorite podcast app and add us. You can listen to great content about all things that are NASCAR. We've had some awesome guests already, and today is certainly another day that I'm going to enjoy getting to know a young racer better. It's Ryan Preece, the modified driver that came to NASCAR, won a couple Xfinity races, and now races in the Monster Energy Cup Series. How did it happen? What's his biggest win? I think you're really going to like that story for many different reasons. So be sure to add us and make sure you tell your friends. We're going to talk to Ryan Preece. We're going to talk all things NASCAR, and we're going to do it all right now on Waltrip Unfiltered.
Green flag, green flag.
Well, welcome to Waltrip Unfiltered, Ryan Preece. Thank you so much for coming by.
Thanks for having me on. Yeah,
this is
cool.
Our plush studios located in Charlotte, North Carolina, here at the Fox Sports headquarters. Got some of my helmets and stuff.
Yeah, got some really nice helmets. Got a nice collection.
Yeah, that's a Matt Kenseth helmet there. He wrecked me one day at Pocono, and when he autographed it, he wrote on there, you see the smudge on the shield? That's why I wrecked you. I couldn't, couldn't see real good.
That's perfect.
So, born in Connecticut. And now racing in NASCAR. I love hearing the stories about how that happened, how you were able to race your way to the big leagues now. You're here. It's happening. And I know the story is about short track racing and modifieds. How did it start?
I mean, there's so many different, there's so many different things you could really start it with. I come from a racing family. My grandfather on my mother's side owned modifieds. And then my father just wanted to race, and when my parents got married, my mom bought him his first race car, street stock. Yeah, so that's there was so much passion on both sides, but I got in modifieds really young, and basically the real breakthrough that I had was when I started driving for Eric Sanderson in 2011. He called me at the end of the season, and Mike Stefanik and him were splitting ways, and Mike left with one race to go, and they put me in the car. We were fastest in practice, qualified on the pole, and dropped a cylinder leading the race. So that's really what got me to where I am now.
One race, other things. One race was that
one
big
race,
of a deal.
Big, yeah. I've had a lot of those moments, I guess, and now that I look back, but and that's what it comes down to. I mean, all us racers, we just want that opportunity, and when you get that opportunity, you have to take advantage of it, right? So. That was kind of like the start of it.
So you were 21 thereabout when you got that big break?
I was 20. I was turning 21 that weekend. Yeah. Yep. Uh-huh. So it's you don't have to be really young to get those opportunities. You know what I mean? You don't have to be 16. You can be 20, 24, 25.
Right. And the question, a thing that I think is interesting is it seems that it's trending younger and younger, but when I started, I didn't even get to drive a go-kart till I was 12. Do you remember what age you were when you finally got to drive something?
Yeah, I was 7. I mean, I've got your typical story of, I've been racing my entire life. We didn't go on vacations. We didn't really do much of anything other than race. That's all we did. My family sacrificed a lot, to do that. So I have pretty much the same story, but at the end of the day, I would say that you don't really have to be 16 years old and signed with someone to make it,
Yeah. And the modified racing up in the Northeast is a culture. I mean, it's more than just going to the races. It's almost like a family, but family that you're liable to fight one night and hug the next, huh?
Oh, man, I've had those nights, too. I mean, I have friends now that, there was almost fights 5 years ago after the races. We all, we have a lot of passion, very passionate fans, very passionate people that own modifieds and drivers, too. Some of the guys that I race there on the Wheel of Modified Tour, even on a weekly basis, that run some of those Connecticut tracks or Long Island tracks or New Hampshire tracks, they aren't slouches. Yeah. You know what I mean? And you got to be on your A game when it comes to restarts, and because otherwise you're going to get caught sleeping and you aren't going to win that race. So that's really, I would say, and guy Bobby Santos, great race car driver, runs midgets, sprint cars, everything. And he said it to me multiple times. Modified racing is some of the toughest racing that you're gonna deal with.
Yeah, your wheels are hanging out.
There's a chance. Don't want to rip one off.
There's a chance if your wheels are hanging off, you're gonna get somebody mad when you dive into hole. Do you recall? I mean, you had to have heroes growing up that were modified stars and really older fellers when you were 20 years old and got your first chance. Do you remember what it felt like to you to line up next to some of those guys?
Yeah, absolutely. So actually, growing up, I always loved watching USAC racing. You know what I mean? I love sprint cars. I love watching Dave Steele, a bunch of those guys. So I just was born in a different part of the country. So that was the easiest route for me to go and really easy for me to go racing at, you know, because Connecticut, New Hampshire, Pennsylvania, everything was super close. So, but then there was a time, so Ted Christopher.
Yeah.
I was really young, and I was probably 13 years old.
He drove for me some.
Did he?
He drove in the Xfinity series for us a little bit.
Oh, I didn't know that. Yeah. So, but I remember I was probably, maybe it was 11 or 12 years old at the time. We were at New Hampshire Motor Speedway, and I believe he was going to start in a cup race that weekend too. But I hopped in a truck with him and went to, I think it was Canaan, or there was some short track up there. We went and watched the race. Fast forward 3 years, he's sticking a Nerf bar to me. Yeah. You know what I mean? Like, and you end up racing against those guys. But guys like them, without them actually talking to you or saying or trying to teach you lessons, they're doing it on the racetrack. And if you're picking up on those things, you start to figure it all out and things start to click as you get older. But, lining up against Ted Christopher, you know, I raced Jerry Marquis, Reggie Ruggiero, Mike Stefanik, Jamie Tomano, like so many guys that I've raced against that, you know, I sit back. I mean, I'm older now, but when I was 18, 19 years old, you really, you know, as you get older, you start to realize like, man, this is, you know, these guys are part of history and like they've done so much. So
right.
It's pretty cool.
Who were your heroes growing up? Like, and it seemed like you said you liked USAC, but it seems like the perfect path to the Monster Energy Cup Series. Mm-hmm. You raced on the short tracks, pavement, then you got Xfinity. And who are your heroes? What led you in the direction you've gone in?
I just loved the race, so I really never chose a path growing up. That was just, I mean, I loved racing and modifieds were the way to go. But my heroes, I mean, Tony Stewart, Mark Martin, Bobby Labonte,
those are pretty good
Jeff
ones.
Jeff Gordon. Yeah, some really good ones. I mean, I jumped around all the time, right?
Yeah.
So Kevin Harvick, you know, all those guys. I liked guys like that. So it was those were kind of my heroes. And it was, I don't know, I never really sat down as a kid and said, I'm going to do this, and this, and this is how it's going to be. It was always, you know, I just wanted to win. That's all I wanted to do. I just wanted to race. And, you know, as opportunities presented itself, I started racing a lot more right when I started probably 18, 19 years old. I went from racing just the wheel and modified tour and maybe a race here and there to I got rides to race weekly at Stafford, Thompson, full-time at Riverhead with a guy named Bill Park, who's a legend over there. And I started racing 20, 25 times a year to anywhere from 70 to 90 times a year.
That's got to be awesome to get to race. I never, when as a kid, I never had those chances to run 70, 80 races.
Yeah.
That has to be a great way for a kid to grow up, knowing that you had to have focus. You had to be dedicated, and it probably put a lot of bad things out of your reach because you knew what you were doing and what you wanted to do.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, no, absolutely. But it is, I mean, it comes with a lot of other things. I mean, you get done at midnight one night and you're up at 5:30 in the morning trying to catch a ferry to go to Long Island to go race the next night, and you're getting home at 3 a.m. the same time because the ferry's not open and you got to drive all the way around the island to come back to Connecticut. So, you know, and that's life.
Yeah.
There was nothing different to me. That's what I did.
What did you know about Joey Logano when you were growing up?
We raced the same track. I've known Joey for, there's actually pictures out there of us together. I think it was the Eastern Grands at one of the tracks that we were at. And one of our buddies has so many pictures of all of us together. But Joey was always really good. You know what I mean? He moved away early on. I would say right when I was getting started is kind of when he was moving away and going to Georgia. I think he was going to start running Legends and late models. So, but Joey's always been a great guy. I've always had a really good relationship with him.
Yeah, so I can envision in my mind that you don't mind mixing it up with Joey. You know him, you're kids. Yeah. What was it like the first time you hit the high banks and there was Kevin Harvick? You're like, man, I grew up looking up to that guy. I think I'm gonna have to put a bumper to him.
Yeah, no, that is definitely something. You know, 15 years ago or 10 years ago, you're sitting watching these guys on TV, and then one day you're getting thrown in the wrestling, you know, the ring with them. So it is different. It's pretty cool, but you gotta turn off that kind of. That you know, fanboy hat off, and you got to go race. So that's part of it.
I remember my first moment in NASCAR when I ran across Dale Earnhardt. So I'm a lot like you. As a kid, all I wanted to do is race, and I had that last name, which obviously helped me open some doors to get some sponsors along the way that enabled me to get to NASCAR. But when I got there, you know, nobody really knew me. It's just Daryl's little brother. And I came off turn two at Darlington in the Southern 500, 1985. And if I can see it right now happening, and it was late, and I was doing pretty, it was my first Southern 500, and I was running the top 20, and I was doing all right. And I come off turn two, and I slipped up. And when I slipped up, I saw in my mirror, it was Dale leading the race, coming up to lap me. And I was like so trying so hard. I made a mistake. You know, I was trying so hard to get away from him this way. And the next thing I know, I look up, he's already over here.
Yeah.
It was like he anticipated I was going to screw up. And so he timed it, did the crossover. And back in the day, the cars were just so different than they are now. You could almost see a guy's feet. You know, you could see his whole body up in those old cars, the big windows. And that finger came out at me and he pointed at me like that.
Yeah.
And I was like, oh, shit, I just almost wrecked Dale Earnhardt.
Yeah.
And. But the finger was, I took it as a way for him to say, get your stuff together.
Yeah.
You're going to race out here with us, you better have your stuff together. I love that moment.
Yeah.
And it was a moment that I almost thought, you know, wow, that was cool. He respected me. He wanted to help me out. I like that. And I just wondered if when you came here in 16, right, to run some Xfinity?
Yep.
How many times did you have to say to yourself, all right, this is the big stage, I got to make sure I know what I'm doing, or was it just another race to you?
It's just another race, to be honest with you. But it's funny, going back to what you're talking about, guys, you know, from what I've heard, everybody always used to talk about guys faking with their hands and all this stuff, and it's like, I look in my mirror and I think to myself, how did they do, who could be able to see that, man? Do my eyes not see as good as theirs or something? But so that's always something I've wondered about, is being able to see in your mirror and actually see the guy's eyes, right? So
look at that helmet, that Country Time helmet. That's from my rookie year in 88.
Yeah.
So that just tells you how wildly different things were then.
Yeah.
And another thing, I'm telling you, it happened and I saw it. I'm running at Dover, and it's a 500 lapper. And, I mean, your seat is basically like riding on a paint can back then, and it's hot as hell. And I needed forearms. Mm-hmm. I was fighting that car so hard. I only had two. Earnhardt laps me. He's sitting just like this.
Yeah.
He's got his right hand on the roll bar, holding himself up, leading the race.
Yeah.
And it was the memories, and you can look it on YouTube, of how you could see this whole guy in that car. It's just so different now.
Yeah. No, absolutely. And that's what it kind of comes back. I talk about modifieds being old school. But there's a racer, Doug Kobe, that I've kind of had a rivalry with.
Yeah.
He drives with one hand and has one hand on the seat, and I look over and I'm just like, what's going on here? Like, I got two hands, I'm driving it, and he's just wheeling it one-handed. So, but then going back to what you were talking about with when you get back on that racetrack and kind of the respect of other drivers, just being out there, for me, I've never thought of that as gaining respect. It's when you get those moments of racing with guys and passing them or setting them up and doing it without touching them. That's, or even you know, getting out of the way when they're racing. You kind of want to have that respect, and that's how you earn respect. You know, and that's how I felt about it. But I've also had points where, you know, Ted Christopher, to be one, him and I went at it quite a bit. where they teach you lessons.
Yes.
I remember there was a big $25,000 to win show at Thompson back in 2011 or 2012. I think it was 2011. We had a really fast car, and they had an invert, and we're driving from 10th, and we're getting there. We finally get the second. I slid, like, you call it a slide job, but in modifieds, it's almost like a Nerf. You know, you use the Nerf bar and kind of make them move them up, and you get by them. Well, that next corner, he went into the corner and used the bumper right on me and moved me right out of the way, and I dropped about 12 spots. So it was like, you aren't going to pass me like that. And he made sure that I wasn't going to do that. So, and that was one of those lessons, like, you can't just do this. You can't bully your way through sometimes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You gotta respect racers. And I know that's how you were raised. I've listened to you say all the time, you know, not to put a bumper on them, just to make the move. That's rewarding when you set up a guy and pull it off cleanly like that.
Yeah. And I try to do the same thing. I mean, I get irritated when I go back to the modifieds and I get somebody who's just, you know, they're all over my bumper hitting me, coming to a start, or, you know, even when we're green, they catch me and run me down. Instead of trying to set me up, they'll just whack you in the middle of the corner. It's like, okay, I'm going to teach you a lesson here, and hopefully you figure it out.
Because it's my job now.
Yeah.
Because I've been there and done that.
Yep.
So let's talk a little bit about your career. 2012, second in the Whelen Modified Tour Series. And then 2013, you won the championship. And then 14, 15, second again. That's a four-year run there where you're pretty solid.
Yeah. No, me and, like I said, Doug Kobe, that's the one who I've kind of been going back and forth with. We've had a rivalry, and it's been a lot of fun. I felt like we pushed each other, to be honest with you. I'm sure you've had this in your career where you've gotten racing someone, and every time you get on that track, they push you to be that much more. And I think you see that in the Cup Series. You see Kyle Busch, Kevin Harvick. You see the elite guys. They push you to get that much more.
Yeah.
And I was just saying to my wife this weekend, I'm like, it's been a while since I've felt like I've needed to really push hard and dig deep. And that's where I'm at right now is, you know, you're digging that much deeper and you're trying to find that much more. And that also goes back to a guy, Ryan Newman. I've been racing him on the modified, you know, whenever he'd run New Hampshire for a while now. And as I started to progress and get into these stock cars, he's like, okay, there's going to be things you feel in these stock cars that when you get back into that modified, you're going to understand why they did what they did. And that just comes down to pushing yourself that much more and noticing all those things as you race more, you know.
He's been impressive in the few starts in the mod that he gets. I like watching that.
Yeah, I love messing with him and talking about modifieds with him, and he loves racing them, so it's going to be fun.
So I think that a lot of times statistics don't tell the whole story, and you're a perfect example of that. I'm an example of that, too. I once lost more races than anyone ever had and then won one. My record of the losses at the beginning of my career and then a win – no one's ever done before. Mm-hmm. There's been a couple of guys in NASCAR that lost more, but they never won. Mm-hmm. And so that's a stat that I have to live with, but I don't think it defines me. I don't believe – I just believe I was better than that. Mm-hmm. And your stats to me are really interesting. I talked about 12, 13, 14, 15 in the modified tour, winning the championship second three times. And in 16, you go Xfinity Racing – and you run the whole series, won top 10, and not a whole lot to really hang your hat on. What did you think at that point? You were so successful in the mods. Mm-hmm. Now you're getting to run NASCAR, which is something that you really wanted to do, but you're not getting the finishes, the results. Where were you mentally in that year?
I was ready to go. I mean, it wasn't one of those where you want to be a big fish in a small pond, go home and go racing. I just want to race to win. And, you know, nothing against the team I was driving for at the time, but I didn't feel like we were going to be able to win unless, you know, something crazy happened at a super speedway or whatever it may have been. It was just that's what I felt. I didn't feel like we could compete with JGR or the RCRs or the Roushes or – you know, all the other elite teams that were there. And it's like, man, I'm a racer. I'm just like, I've come from winning, you know, I was winning anywhere from 15 to 20 races a year to not even feeling like I could contend. And that's part of that, being on that side of the garage. You don't have tires every time you pit.
Yeah.
There's just there's other obstacles that you got to deal with. So, like you're talking about stats. Yeah, it's frustrating. I got one top 10 at Darlington, and that was it. And
but you had to walk away from there thinking it's a top 10 at Darlington.
Yeah.
Darn it.
Yeah, but that was, you know, at the time, too, that was kind of strategy worked out really well. It wasn't, you know, I like earning things, and I didn't completely feel like I earned that top 10. You know, it was we ended up there.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So 17 is a whole different story. Yep. I know you're racing your mod and won the owner's championship.
Yeah.
My timeline's right?
You got this nailed. And actually, so that was – I took over everything on the modified side. Crew chief, you know, getting the car prepared, everything. And I'll never forget this because I felt like I got the respect to my father that weekend is – I went to a race for the first time without him, all by myself, with four of my buddies. All right, we go up to New Hampshire, and it's a big race, and I won. And I remember I woke up the next day, or my spotter told my father, he's like, "Oh, Ryan won this weekend." I was like, "What? What?" You know what I mean? Because it was just one of those moments, like, my kid can do this. Yeah. You know what I mean? I don't have to hold his hand. He's capable. And right. That was pretty cool. But yeah, going into 17, that was a big year between the modified stuff. We won the owner championship. We won a lot of races. I think that was one of my winningest years on the modified tour and in a modified. And obviously the JGR stuff.
All right. This seems out of left field. All of a sudden, four opportunities in a Joe Gibbs car. Now, it takes money to do that. Nobody's mm-hmm. going to act like it doesn't.
Yep.
It takes talent to win and money to get here.
Yep.
And money can get you here, but money won't keep you here.
Yeah. No, yeah.
I've lived all this, so I know it pretty good.
Mm-hmm.
How did you get together with JGR and get those four races? And then the way you performed was just awesome. Yeah.
So when obviously everybody knew Carl Edwards retired and Daniel moved up, I lived in Kevin Mannion Bono's race shop when I was down here. And when I moved home, when all that happened, I had the TV on. I knew what was going on. And he called me. He said, "Hey, you need to call Steve D'Souza." And what happened was, is I raced for so many good people and had really good relationships with them. They knew that if I got the right opportunity that I would do what I did. And I believed in it. There was no ifs, ands, or buts. There was no, I'm going to finish fifth. I'm going to do this. There was, I'm going to win. I'm going to do whatever it took. And so as soon as I got done talking to Steve, you know, I had multiple people along with some backers that helped me make it possible. And, you know, it comes down to the right place at the right time. I think you hear people talk about it all the time. I'm sure you've been there mm-hmm. along with seen it by multiple people. And, you know, I'm very fortunate to be surrounded by the people that I've been surrounded by and that I'm still friends with to this day. And I still talk to them on a weekly basis.
So in the discussion with Steve, they said, "We got four races. If you want them, you can."
It was two races, actually. Yeah. So it was only supposed to be two.
Right. Yep. So you were able to get sponsorship, run two races, and, mm-hmm. and you won Iowa.
I won Iowa and finished second in New Hampshire to Kyle.
And yep. So you're thinking, "I knew I was right."
Well, I was, and you want to know what? And I remember I was sitting under the, when I got the call to run Kentucky, I was sitting under pulling the transmission out, getting ready to go run Loudon on the modified tour in like a week. So that was a complete like, okay, here we go. This is another opportunity I got to do. We got to do what we can to win this one too.
Yeah.
And Chris Gabehart was the crew chief. And we were running second to Tyler Reddick at the time. And that was when the 42, I mean, they were just so fast at Kentucky. And him and I both agree, we're both racers. We want to win that race. So he's like, "All right, I can take a big swing at it." I'm like, "Just do it." All right, well, we do that, and we're running second. I mean, I am looser than Steve Kinzer, you know, out there. So we definitely did what we needed. You know, we tried to do what we thought we needed to do, and we ended up fourth that race. But I had a lot of fun with those guys, for sure.
It was so cool to see you come on the scene and know that everything that had gone into it, and then you get the results. So, you know, you get the accomplishments of having the success. And then it led to where you are today.
Mm-hmm.
And where you are today, I think, is interesting because you've been here before. You're in a team. You're with a team that's awesome. I love Tad and Jody. I love all the marketing they do, and the cars are nearly there.
Yeah.
But you know, you're just a notch off, whether it's setup or aero, whatever it is, but you're a notch off. And when you start a season like you have in 2019, how do you departmentalize and keep everything straight in your brain to go out and do the best you can?
That's tough. I think, you know, just like any racer, racing's full of highs and full of a lot of lows, and they can really get you down. But there's times, you know, that's why I continue to race my modified and do those, because it keeps you going. Like, okay, I won here. I know it's at this stage, but I still won. Like, you know what I mean? But going back, JTG, I said this at the beginning of the season. They aren't, you know, it's not the same situation, because they are a very well-funded team, you know, thanks to Kroger, Maxwell House, and all our partners. They have tires every week. I joke with Ernie Cope, who's the competition director, and Tad. When I sat down with them, one of the first questions I asked was, do you guys buy the full allotment of tires? Because,
That's where you've been your whole life. If we don't have tires, we can't win.
Yeah, pretty much. So it's, you know, they have brand new cars. They build brand new cars. It's all in-house. They have a Hendrick Motorsports engine deal with them, and we're provided with great power. So we have the tires, we have the chassis, we hang our own bodies, and we have the power. I don't see it. I mean, I know there's a lot of technology that goes into these things, but you've seen the stories where the underdog ends up beating the big dog.
Yes.
And I feel like if hard work's put there, if the hard work's put in and everything aligns, you'll see that story again. It just comes down to not being willing to say, okay, well, this is going to be where we're going to end up being.
Yeah.
And I've kind of had that attitude my entire life, is I'm not willing to accept the fact that I'm just going to run here. I'm going to do whatever it takes to get here.
Yes.
And that's what I think, if you want to be successful, that's the way you have to be.
Well, and when the season started, there was a lot of highs for you. I mean, mm-hmm. some good performances, and then several top 20s, you know,
yeah.
several running up toward where you want to be. Then you run third at Talladega, which was an awesome finish and a great job, mm-hmm. by the way. But since then, it just doesn't seem like things are working out mm-hmm. as well. And as a driver that's a winner, and you talk about having all the parts and pieces, do you try to immerse yourself more in the team and go to the shop and say, how do I help? What can I do? Or do you let the smart people handle all that? How's that work for you?
I think that's a fine line. I think you have to stay involved to understand kind of what direction that you're heading. But at the same time, there's people that are hired to do what they're doing for a reason. They're smart, right? So it's kind of one of those things where we're going through a little bit of a rough period, I would say. But I have confidence in everybody around me to help dig us climb out of that hole, right? Mm-hmm. You know, I think we were ahead of Daniel in the rookie points by a good margin. He's kind of surpassed us and passed. So, but we got a whole second half of the season. We kind of got to regroup, and we got a teammate. You know, Chris, he's great to work with. He's a great guy, and you know, just kind of lean on him a lot and move forward and try to get some good results.
Yeah, you talked about your friend Daniel. You want a bright spot here and. Here and there every now and then, and you were in California on the road course racing your buddy Daniel.
Yep. Yeah, Daniel and I, we've actually, Daniel's a great guy, and he's a great racer, and we've met each other along the way. He actually raced on the modified tour at one point too, so like at certain points in our career, we've kind of like came back together and raced each other, and then we split apart. You know, our paths have crossed so many different times.
What a great guy though.
Yeah.
I mean, I love him.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, he's awesome. He's always been great to me.
Yeah. Well, and that brings me to the point of bringing up the K&N race in California. Daniel sent out a tweet that basically said, Ryan didn't jump, I just didn't go.
Yeah.
That's pretty cool that he would do that, but it also kind of makes me mad that you didn't win that race.
Yeah. I mean, it's like I said.
If you're a competitor, you supposedly jump, said you didn't jump.
Then, yeah, I don't know. It's
I'm sure it's hard for you to.
It's a tough situation here,
sort
but
through.
You know, and that comes back to, he got such a good restart the one before that. He actually passed me, and then we had the yellow flag, and, you know, since their rules are a little different, I got the lead back, right?
You ought to have seen Daryl and I. We were up in
the... Were you confused? Yeah. Like, what's going on here?
We were up in the carousel, and they would crash, and the yellow would come out, and people would be driving around each other under caution. So, but that's the rules.
Yeah, so coming to turn 11, that hairpin, whatever you want to call it, I heard he was in second gear, and I'm like, I'm going to back the pace up and see if he downshifts. And he downshifted, and, you know, he spun his tires really bad. So I'm like, okay, his gearing's a little different than my transmission. I'm gonna do this a little different here.
And the reason why you know that was because you were under your modified pulling a transmission out. So you understand all
Well, I've been around. I've won races on restarts, and I've lost races on restarts. And, you know, that Iowa, I go back and I think about that last green-white checkered at Iowa with me and Kyle Benjamin. That was a life changer right there. And I wasn't, and I said the same, I said to my wife, Heather, I'm like, when, on that last one at K&N restart, I said, I'm not giving this race up. Yeah. I'm going to win this race. And that's the attitude you have to have if you want to win. You know, you got to dig deep, and it doesn't matter whether it's in a go-kart, on a bike, or you know, in the Cup Series, you're doing the same thing. So, but yeah, no, it's a tough situation. I like winning. I like trophies. I've never won a road course race in my entire life because I haven't done very many. And those guys brought me a great race car, and I thought that race, you know, that restart was Clorox clean. So I don't know. Yeah.
The car was Clorox clean all that racing too. Yeah. Everybody else's stuff was torn to pieces. And you talked about Kroger giving you the chance to run both of them out there. That was a really cool weekend for you.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you know? No, it's awesome. I mean, I'm very lucky to be with Tad and Jody and everybody over there at JTG and JTG Doherty. And, you know, just we'll get out of that hole and we'll start pushing for some better finishes.
Well, and they take good care of you. I saw your Kroger commercial where they brush your teeth and clean your ears.
Yeah, it's crazy. It's almost like they do everything for me.
So as a kid, did you – I know you talk about being a racer and how you just like being behind the wheel. Did you have a great concept for all the marketing that would need to be put into being that racer that you are?
No. I'm not a marketing guy. I remember I tried early on to try to put together packages, and I didn't understand how to sell it. I didn't understand the B2B side of it or anything like that. I just knew a logo on a race car, and there's so much more to it. So when it came, you know, and I've always been really lucky. People have approached me. When it came to local racing, you know, I was racing for a chassis builder at the time at Stafford Motor Speedway, and a sponsor actually sent an email to the racetrack saying they wanted to get in contact with me to sponsor RSK so we could race more. And that's kind of how that happened. And, you know, there's just stuff like that. It's just, I guess winning had a lot to do with it, but also having a, you know, not being a punk kid or anything like that kind of helped the whole cause.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And it's interesting to me because it seems Chris is the same way. Y'all do the grilling commercials together and doing all the stuff that Tad and Jody are so great at, and Brad Daugherty. But it looks like you're enjoying it. I mean, it's just part of it, right?
They do a great job with the commercials. They're actually fun to shoot, and they do them really quick, but they come together so well. I mean, I go back and watch them. And usually I try not to watch any of that stuff, but they're fun. You know, they do a really good job.
Speaking of marketing, we're the Fox family, and we had our last race this weekend in Sonoma, and it was Daryl's last race in the broadcast booth. And I have a question. I haven't asked you about this. When we came over to see you on the grid walk, and you said to him, I am comfortable in my car.
Yeah.
Is that the first time you'd ever said that to him?
Mm-hmm.
Is that the first conversation y'all really had?
That's really one of the first conversations. I mean, I always drive by, I see his nice, cool golf cart. Well, I don't even know what that thing is. It's cool, though. But, that was really, like, one of the first conversations I've ever had with him. But I go back, I watch practices. That's part of my routine, you know, just to see what other people are doing. Because when you're in that car, you're in your own little world, right? You only know what's going on in your cockpit and your car. So I like to go back and watch stuff. And between him and Jeff, I remember Jeff at Daytona, he's like, you might want to put some padding in there. And I'm just like, I feel comfortable. And I'm not sore after races. It's just that's how I feel. That's how I feel natural, you know? And it's weird. I know people. So JGR always called it the Hans check. Whenever I go like this, I'm just naturally doing it. I don't know.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
I thought it was funny that I assumed that y'all had never talked about it, and I knew what I knew what you were talking about because I watch all that stuff too, and I love every bit of it. As we head to Chicago and get ready for the summer stretch, what do you think is going to help you take that next step? What do you think is going to propel you into the top 15, top 10? I know you got the parts and pieces. It's just repetitions too. That'll help as well.
With the package the way it is, it's kind of similar to go-kart racing in a way. But you got to be wide open, right? And not scrubbing speed. And there's so many different ways to get these cars to do what you want to do. I mean, you can bump stop, you can coil bind, you can pretty much do anything. I mean, it's just really what's going to keep your best aero platform for when you lose that downforce. And I think it's just trying to find the setup we need right now to be able to do those things and kind of bump us from where we are to there.
So I had an idea last night at about 2 a.m. that I that I would ask fans to tweet me questions and I would get you to answer them. And so I wanted to read a couple and you tell me your answer. Thomas Jarrett wants to know, what was your favorite DW call?
Yeah, so that's tough. I mean,
so many.
Yeah, there was a lot of them. I mean, you tell me some of your good stories here.
Well, my favorite one was when, I won Daytona, and he said, "You got it, Mikey." But unfortunately, that day turned
kind of
crappy. Yeah. But that was a great moment in time, if you will. I got another question from a NHL fan. Do you enjoy running Riverhead? And did you ever look up to Steve Park since y'all took the same route to NASCAR?
So when I was younger, he took off, and I knew he raced modifieds. I do love running Riverhead. That's actually – it's a quarter-mile bull ring. It's like the Bowman Gray of the Northeast, right? So but Steve Park – so I still – and I was telling you a little bit about this. He has a shop down here, and I break my phone a lot because I drop it on the ground or it falls out of my pocket under the car.
Do you go to his battery and
– Bulbs and Plus, yeah. Yep, I go over there. So I always like – hearing his stories.
Oh, he's awesome.
And he's told me a few of them about him and Dale.
Yeah.
You know, and how when he was living at Dale's house, Dale would come in early in the morning, kick his bed and tell him to get up. You know what I mean? Or even the time he was working for him. But, maybe one day you'll have to have him on or whatever. But
no doubt. He's on the list. And
he's awesome.
I got a refreshing Steve Park visit a couple weeks ago. We saw each other down in Charlotte, and it was fun catching up.
Mm-hmm. So going back, and this is kind of what put it all into perspective for me, because I always used to say, and we almost all use the term fun loosely, right? We talk about having fun, and to me, just like Steve, I always said, Steve, do you miss racing? And he looked at me and said, Ryan, I miss winning. And to me, that really hit home. I'm like, you know what? That makes sense. Like, That's what I love doing. That's how I have fun, is winning. So that was my Steve Park story. That's what made me really realize a lot of things about me, my love of racing, but how competitive I really am.
Yeah, and he is such a great guy, and to have what y'all have in common, and then now have that moment when he made you realize, yeah, you sound just like me.
Yeah, it was crazy. Yeah, it was like it clicked. So
what has been your biggest win, single win so far in your career? Was it Iowa? Was it Bristol?
Well,
was it —
that's the tough part.
The Spring Sizzler. Like I like all those races.
There is a lot of races. So I categorize them. They're all different. They all have different meanings.
Yeah.
Iowa was a huge moment for me because that's what got me to where I am. That's that and Bristol. Bristol was what solidified it. That New Hampshire race I told you about where I earned the respect of my father, that was one of the biggest wins for me emotionally. You know, when I won that race, I always talked — actually, going back early in my career, I always won races and I got out of the car and I would, you know, you do the whole thing, you're happy. But it was like a feeling of emptiness in a way, because I wasn't preparing the cars back then. I was just driving them. And when I put all that work into that car and I went and I won that race, it was like, man, all this hard work, it paid off. And that's where all the emotion came in. And that's where it was like, okay, from then on out, it was, you know, every race had so much more meaning to it. And so that was one of the biggest wins.
Yeah.
And it wasn't one of the biggest races that I've ever won. So it's weird. I mean, Martinsville, I've won there. Bristol on a modified. I mean, I don't really have one, you know. But I would obviously say Iowa and Bristol are some of the biggest, were the biggest wins for my career.
Well, my favorite win right now is the one at New Hampshire with your dad. Like, because you put that car together.
Oh, yeah.
And you knew how, like, you didn't ask him for his blessing.
Yeah.
And you, it was a big moment for you because you built the car.
Yeah.
So obviously your father knows everything about you because he was able to say, son, wow.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. I remember my mom looking at me and saying, you know, he's proud of you. So that was, still remember it just like you remember in 1985 at Darlington with Dale Earnhardt pointing out his window. You know, it was a cool memory for me.
Waltrip Word Association, we do this every week with the guys. And the funniest one was when I said Larson to Tyler Reddick. And he said they took a little bit of great race car driver and just dumped it all over him.
Uh-huh.
That's the respect that Kyle Larson had from Reddick.
Yeah.
Who do you have that kind of feeling for today on the track? Who do you think is getting the most out of their car? And I got to figure out another word. I got to use the word association game, but it just led me to think about that. What do you see that you like a lot out there on the track?
I mean, a lot of these guys are really good. Like, that's why they're there, right? But, I mean, you see guys like Kevin Harvick and Kyle Busch, Martin Truex. You know, these guys all get a lot. You know, they dig deep and get that little bit more. So, you know, I have a lot of respect for all these guys, every single one of them. I wouldn't say necessarily I respect one more than the other. But, yeah, these, you know, hopefully one day I can actually be racing against them and – or when I mean racing against them, racing them for a win on a green white checkered, right?
That's what it's all about.
Yep.
And wow, man, that was a lot of fun. I love Ryan Preece, such a racer, a kid that really had a plan, and the plan had to change, and he adapted to it and is making the most of it. Awesome to spend time with these young drivers and get to know who they are, where their heart is, what drives them, and you can tell Ryan's just a guy that loves to race. And I'm a guy that loves to talk about racing. And you know what else I'd love? For you to tell your friends about Waltrip Unfiltered and add us via your favorite podcast app. You can also check out Twitter, Facebook, YouTube for great videos from our podcast. I think you'll enjoy those. We add them up every day. So thanks for listening so much. Looking forward to next week.